Mexico has shown great pace here at Sentul, not just this year, but last season as well. Great Britain and USA on the second row. Germany very fast in the wet in Malaysia. He starts fifth ahead of Australia. Then behind them, we've got France, all the experience of Nicolas Lapierre. Sean McIntosh, former winner here, next to him. Then South Africa and Switzerland. Row six, Italy and Malaysia. Alex Jung could go well in these conditions. So could Jeroen Bleekemolen, starting 13th for the Netherlands. Mikkola alongside him. Then we've got Brazil and the Czech Republic. Ireland in 17th place, India 18th. Then Lebanon 19th, Pakistan starts 20th. And at the back, courtesy of a spin and damage suspension, which got broken when he was bouncing across the grass. Ho Pin Tung for China, his second race in A1GP. About to come up here, and the longest race, of course. I should think that he's contested. He's come out of Formula 3, but we'll have to wait and see how he gets on in this one. You rejoin us here at Sentul in Indonesia, where I'm glad to say the rain has eased off. There's still some falling on start-finish straight, but the conditions are quite different to what we saw about half an hour ago. The race was started, it began behind the safety car, but after just one lap, the red flag came out. It was all stopped. The cars were put back on the grid. They were absorbing water from every direction. But now, thankfully, it's all eased off, and we're looking at a start in under 10 minutes. Great views around this track. It's real jungle next to the Sentul circuit. There's not much development around here. As you come into the entrance to the track, there are a few small buildings and shacks serving food and selling other bits and pieces. But really, pretty much we are in the jungle here. And as you can see, lots of vantage points from all around the track. But the question is, are we going to see those cars up and running? I think we are. We're still looking at a start time in about 4.5 minutes.
But the question, and there you get an idea of just how much the wind is picking up. It's all a contribution. The wind and the rain have been coming together in pulses. It's been coming one direction, then diametrically opposite the next. So we're having a little look around, and the weather still uncomfortable. Sean McIntosh for Canada sitting in his car. He popped in that car just a few moments ago, and I suspect that pretty much everybody in the grid has opted to go for the full wet race setup, because in spite of the high ambient temperatures, it's not going to be a dry track, certainly not until we get maybe halfway through at the earliest.
Neil Yani struggled a bit in the wet in Malaysia, but it looked to me as though they'd stayed pretty much with a dry setup, because he struggled for traction in the early stages of the race. He'd won the sprint race, but had no real grip in the early stages, and it was Germany, of course, who rocketed past him on the first lap. Could be a different story. He has great amount of experience. He's driven the A1 car in the wet in the past several times, of course, from last year, as well as in Malaysia last time out. Could expect good things. Here's Alan van der Merwe, another of the rookie drivers driving for South Africa. Of course, Adrian Zaug took the first win of the season driving for South Africa. And Alan van der Merwe, who's a former British F3 champion, who hasn't been racing regularly because he's been testing Formula One cars the last couple of years, recently set a new world speed record in a Formula One car on the salt flats at Bonneville. Somewhat different weather conditions, I should think, he experienced there.
Well, actually, funnily enough, driving at Bonneville on the salt flats in a Grand Prix car on groove tires, and there you see the rain coming down again fairly heavily. It is actually about as slippery as it's going to be here today at Sentul on a set of wet weather Cooper tires in an A1 GP car. It is not a walk in the park to drive any car on a salt flats, because inherently they're unstable, and it is quite tricky to keep the car pointing in the right direction. Now, looking down to turns 3 and 4, the rain is beginning to fall more heavily down at the far end of the racetrack than we've seen at any point so far this afternoon, as we look at the safety car sitting there, and that's further around the racetrack, just looking to see that's coming out of turn 2, looking into turn 3 on the, just at the top of the picture.
Yeah, I wonder why a safety car is sitting up at that end of the circuit. They're maybe just keeping an eye on weather conditions. As we know, it can be different at different parts of the track. We've got the race officials by the start line, so they know what it's doing here, but they might want a heads up for what it's doing elsewhere. Looking back down at Team Malaysia, and Alex Jung, I think he's been sitting there most of the time. I haven't seen him out of the car. He's just been very, very cool, very patient, just waiting for the moment when they're going to be getting that chance to get going. And we're looking at the start of the formation lap in just 2 minutes.
All around the racetrack, people taking protection. Of course, there are various opportunities for these fans to see themselves on the TV screens that are available for them to watch. As Jaroslav Janis in the Czech Republic, and this is the back of the field, just one position ahead of Ireland. Ireland on the ninth row of the grid, and the Czech Republic further forward on the seventh row. So
another new driver there too. It's Jaroslav Janis, who has driven Formula 3000 cars a lot over the last few years, mainly in Europe. Pretty impressive on Friday, but he didn't seem to dial it in so well for qualifying. Thomas Enger, normal driver for the Czech Republic, he's busy in America, I believe, this weekend, so it's an opportunity for Jaroslav Janis to show what he can do. He's driven in the rookie sessions in the past in A1GP, but it is actually his first race weekend. Got a result earlier on, but he chased Brazil hard throughout the sprint race, couldn't really find a way past, and we'll have to see what he can do in the wet.
That safety car still is waiting down at the entry to turn three. We haven't seen it being brought round to the head of this field, so it looks to us, all intents and purposes, that the cars make their way around for, once again, this formation lap. Whether they get picked up down at turn three by the safety car, and once again this race will start under a safety car or not, that's something we will not know until we get down to turn three. But the rain again falling heavily on start finish straight, not as bad as it was some 30 minutes ago, but it is still chucking it down.
Phil Giebler for Team USA didn't seem to be tall worried about the wet weather conditions in Holland at the start of the season, when he was the only man really to stay on slick tyres in rainy conditions. Obviously he's on wet here like everybody else. No one would dare start in these conditions on anything other than a full wet weather tyre. But the question is, who's going to deal with it the best, and how are you going to find your way through the gloom if you're in the middle of the pack? We're waiting for the green flag to signal the start of the formation lap, which will take place in just a moment. There we go. Green flag waves, and away we go. New Zealand leads the pack away. Mexico, Great Britain, Germany all off the grid safely, and all of them just doing a little bit of a practice start. It's so easy, John, in these conditions to just sit there with the wheel spinning, isn't it?
Well, what normally people would do in a dry start is run the engine up to the limiter, drop the clutch, and then just balance the wheel spin on the throttle. In these conditions, you want virtually the lowest amount of RPM to get the car rolling, and then just short shift the gear changes until you get to the higher gears, fourth, fifth, and sixth. But the level of traction right now is just about zero, and it will just take a little bit of experience for those that have it to see the best of it. There we see cars now as they come down up into turn three. You can see just the amount of spray, particularly as they come out of two. There is some of the old surface there. This is new surface on the approach into turn three.
Everybody looking for a bit of clear vision if possible. There is Vulindlela, the South African car. Clear the way, that means, and that's definitely what they need in these conditions, isn't it? To clear the way, to see where they're going. That's going to be the challenge for Alan van der Merwe and all the other drivers out there this afternoon. Looking further back, Richard Lyons, Team Ireland, the very distinctive Dayglow green car. And Lyons, of course, in his first weekend in an A1GP machine.
And just look at the spray as they come through turn five on that very shiny part of racetrack. A lot of drivers, I suspect, particularly those in the mid-pack, will want to be well out to the right, because their vision is going to be virtual, it will be negligible. And there you see again the run down as the lead car comes up. This is into turns eight and nine. So it is track conditions are drivable, are raceable, but marginal.
So it looks as though they're going to be coming back down onto the grid, presumably for the standing start. That's what we're expecting to see. And New Zealand leads the way down towards turns 10 and 11. And then we'll see them come around.
Now Johnny Reid needs to slow this field down because he wants to get the pack as tight together as he comes onto the grid. He doesn't want to sit there too long. So there's an idea of what the visibility is like. It is virtually negligible. And they're on board, well, that's Mexico running directly behind Team GBR on the second row of the grid.
They're looking to line up now in their grid positions. They're following one another until they get to their allocated row, and then they'll file off into their correct positions. New Zealand on the pole position, huge advantage, but can they get off the line cleanly? Very difficult to accelerate away, as we've been talking about already. Mexico on that front row with New Zealand. The second row is Great Britain and the United States. The third row, Germany, and we know how quick Germany was in Malaysia last time. Australia's on the third row as well. France and Canada together on row four. Row five, see South Africa and Switzerland. Row six, Italy and Malaysia. Row seven, the Netherlands and Indonesia. Row eight, Brazil and the Czech Republic. Row nine, Ireland and India. Then Lebanon, Pakistan and China complete the grid. Everybody now virtually in position. Few more at the back.
Yes, just watching France, Nicolas Lapierre doing what I thought many will do, and that's flip open the bottom bit of the visor just to allow, particularly standing on the grid, to get some fresh air and to prevent any condensation.
The feature race here in Indonesia at last is ready to get underway for the second time of the day. In fact, we're looking at a race start. Somebody seemed to be slightly out of position, but the start signal is given anyway. Away we go. New Zealand makes a beautiful getaway. Mexico is set. Germany's away very well. Keep an eye on Germany. They were very quick off the line there, and he's into third place. But Great Britain going around the outside, side by side. Germany claims third.
And Germany looking to find a way past Mexico. Robbie Kerr tried to do that, but what the advantage is that New Zealand's got now under the very, very wet part of track. Germany on the inside, Mexico on the right, the left-hand side coming into turn three. Mexico comes across the block. Germany going down. Great Britain in fourth.
And look at Alan van der Merwe for South Africa. He's got past Team France. Big twitch, but he saved it beautifully. Ryan Briscoe of Australia not away very well, so he's lost a few places there. And USA have also lost places as Germany on the attack again. It's Nico Hülkenberg going for second place if he can squeeze past Mexico.
He can. He's got it. He went down the inside. He took no prisoners going into turn five and six. But what's the rest of the field? We've got Canada, Malaysia side by side into turn six. Netherlands running behind.
That's right, but Germany now, but a second look at Great Britain. Great Britain trying to take third place from Mexico. Salvador Duran wants to fight his way, but he can't do it. Robbie Kerr is in third.
Duran struggled to get traction coming out of turn seven, and that allowed Robbie Kerr to get the run on him. Now he's under pressure from Team South Africa, Alan van der Merwe.
Salvador Duran really struggling in these conditions. Whatever they've changed on the car is not making him very quick. And now it's South Africa who wants to find a way past the Mexican car. New Zealand lead, and there was a beautiful getaway by Johnny Reid.
Wind runs wide. Salvador Duran on the grass, pulls the car back. But where is he? We can't even see the car in the spray.
New Zealand come across the line leading from Germany. Great Britain, look at this. South Africa
almost alongside coming down to the turn one. He's on the outside of the corner.
We can't see it, now we can, and they emerge through the gloom still with Mexico in fourth place, South Africa is fifth, and then France in sixth place behind them. Malaysia's up to
seventh. Oh, and Alan van der Merwe got a slide on as he came through turn two. We can't see anything, what can the driver see? Yeah, in the meantime, Germany now closing down onto the tail of Team New Zealand.
These two rivals, the two sister teams, let's see us again, South Africa, very close into the back, yes, Duran's
wide. Easy, he took the run over the concrete, he found the bite. Whatever the setup on the car Mexico is, it is not a setup that's appropriate for these wet conditions.
South Africa up into fourth position, this is a great start, although Mexico's not given up the battle. Salvador Duran can't quite squeeze alongside. Malaysia, by the way, up to seventh place. So Alex Jung had a great first lap. Look at Germany slithering and sliding.
Well, that's the part of racetrack which leads into turn eight and nine. It's just like a polished surface, and you've got to be gentle putting the power on. Johnny Reid can do that because he's got total visibility. Those behind are struggling.
So further back, USA in eighth place, Italy in ninth, then it's Canada and Australia, but the lead battle is between New Zealand and Germany. Germany so fast in these wet conditions, and he's got a great exit again. This could be the battle for the lead then. New Zealand going to the inside. Where's Germany going to go? Does he go tight to the pit wall? Is he going to make the move into the first corner?
Well, if he does, it's going to be from a long, long way behind, but he gets up and not quite alongside. He has to be careful. These are two nations that are run out of one camp. But Johnny Reid catches the curb on the outside of turn one. That gives once again Nico Hülkenberg the opportunity to try and get into position. Now he pulls out. He's not far enough up coming into turn three.
No, he's not going to make a move, I think, into turn number three. But Johnny Reid is under pressure here from Nico Hülkenberg of Germany. And Germany have been so strong all throughout this season, and particularly in the wet weather conditions. Again, he's closing.
Just looking at the two cars coming off turn four, either Johnny Reid's throttle control or it is Nico Hülkenberg's desire to get the speed as quick as possible, but the New Zealand car looks the marginally more stable of the two cars at this point.
Both of them looking for grip, still learning the circuit in these wet conditions. Neither of them have raced here or driven in the wet at Sentul, whereas some of the other drivers were here last year and practiced in the wet, but these two guys are showing them how to do it. But remember, these two cars are set up by the same outfit. They're identically prepared, and it's between the two drivers. Let's see what happened to Mexico.
Well, you can tell what we got, that it is virtually impossible to see anything from the seat. Well, there's what's happened. He went off track. Salvador Duran blinded, and he's off the track. And that's the reason why Mexico have dropped down to fifth place.
Yeah, they may have dropped more than that, I think, actually. That's that they're further down than
and
that.
That's
he hasn't come round.
I think that's turn six he went off.
Oh, dear. Poor old Salvador Duran. So he's dropped down the order. The leaders are back across the line then. It's still New Zealand, Germany, then a gap back to Great Britain. Robbie Kerr running third for GBR. South Africa in fourth place for Alan van der Merwe. There's the gap back to third. Wait for South Africa to emerge. There it is. And then it's France next up and Malaysia, because they've got past Mexico, who had that problem on the last lap. Mexico will come through, I think, in seventh position. Have a look. Yeah, there he is. Still in seventh. Eighth place for USA. Ninth place for Italy. Tenth for Canada. Then it's the Netherlands coming through the gloom. Indonesia, who's gained a bit. And then Brazil. Ireland. Ireland ahead of the Czech Republic there. So Ireland 14th, 15th, the Czech Republic. Then China, India, and Australia. I don't know what happened to Ryan Briscoe early on, but
well,
he's now right
back. We didn't see what happened to Ryan Briscoe at all, but I don't think anybody could have picked it up because there was so much gloom out there, it was virtually impossible. Now things are beginning to settle down. Nico Hülkenberg for Germany has realised the strengths that Johnny Reid's got in the Team New Zealand car, and it's a more of a situation of consolidation and weight. Track conditions still really no indication of improvement whatsoever. The volume of water that has fallen over the last hour is still greater than the ability for the track to dry out.
So maybe the top two are deciding not to fight it out at the moment. They want to try and ease away from third place to Great Britain if possible. Coming through the gloom is Phil Giebler of the United States. Enrico Tocacello going well for Team Italy. Now up in ninth position, so from where he started at the beginning of the sprint race, he has gained ground throughout the day.
Interestingly, the fastest lap so far isn't from the first three cars, it's coming from the fourth car from South Africa, Alan van der Merwe, in his first A1 GP car, currently fastest man on track, until New Zealand have now just eclipsed it.
Yeah, race leader's just gone a fraction quicker. Mexico still battling hard with Team USA. They're the next one who's going to try and get past Team Mexico. So I think Salvador Duran really fighting the car a little bit out there today. No, he's passed already. USA 7.
This is what happened to Mexico. Now, is this a repeat of what happened, or is this a second venture into the gravel? I think that might be a repeat of what occurred just one lap ago.
I'm not sure, actually, whether I think that might have been when he lost the place to the United States, just that last lap, and it's Italy that's behind him now. So, oh dear, he's not going well at all. His Team Mexico had a podium in the first race, but the car looks as though it may well be a bit too stiff for these wet conditions, and he's struggling to keep it on the island. So, USA 7th now. Malaysia is up to 6th place, of course, remember. We're looking at the two race leaders, New Zealand followed by Germany, and there's the gap that they have opened up over Great Britain. A bit closer to Great Britain is South Africa.
Well, South Africa has been trading fastest laps with race leader New Zealand, and they're closing down South Africa on Great Britain. It's 1.2 seconds, and they went across start-finish line, but was less midway round this lap.
Germany carrying more speed into
the corner. Oh, he's picked this time off the corner. He's going to get under the wing. He may look at taking a chance to get well. You can see how close he is. We're looking to see both are on the power boost button. New Zealand and Germany are using it for the second time, in fact, and not far enough up to put himself into position. But he might get a run off the corner. He's alongside. He's done it.
He's taken the lead.
He forced the error from Johnny Reid. He forced him to break later into turn one than Reid would want to do, and that was the result. He made a very sensible, mature. What a great pass from Germany.
Germany takes the lead then and have found a way through and passed New Zealand. Now, are we going to see him do what he did in Malaysia? Here we are once again.
Again, Johnny Reid just too deep into the corner, couldn't slow the car down. Nico Hülkenberg, he forced that situation. He applied the pressure to New Zealand and he got the result.
So Germany now leads New Zealand in second place. And Nico Hülkenberg, who at times in Malaysia was up to 2.5 seconds a lap faster than everyone else in the rain. Let's see what he can do this time. He's in front. Third and fourth, Great Britain and South Africa. Then the gap back. It's Team France in fifth position. Behind them is Team Malaysia with Alex Jung. And then there's another little bit of a gap back to the United States that's running in seventh place. In a bit of clear air now, the United States, but not lapping as fast as Team Malaysia further up the road. Look at Hülkenberg. He's stretching out the advantage.
Well, his last lap was the fastest lap of the race. That was a 1:27.7. And already he's opened up the best part of 2 seconds advantage over New Zealand. Robbie Kerr, the back end, just catching that white painted line as he turns in to turn 10.
It's you've got to be careful in these conditions. So easy to make a little mistake. France and Malaysia are much more careful about not getting onto the white line.
1:26.421. That is the time for Nico Hülkenberg.
That's a remarkable time.
It's just about 10 seconds off the fastest single lap we've seen here all weekend. 10 seconds difference between appalling conditions and perfect dry ones.
Yeah, but the key thing is it's 2 seconds faster than just about everyone else is doing, John. They're in the 1:28.
Well, that's what we saw in Malaysia 2 weeks ago. And the ability of this driver, I mean, cat-like reactions to drive at that speed. I mean, these are as bad conditions as you can get in any wet motor race that we've ever seen.
Further back, the Netherlands running in 11th place there. Ahead of them was Canada and Italy. There's a drive-through penalty being called for Lebanon and India. Don't know what that refers to, but there is a drive-through for Lebanon and India. So that's going to keep them at the back. Lebanon's in 20th place. India actually in 18th position. So
we did see, as the cars were on the grid before the red lights went out, that there was movement from some cars at the back of the field. So maybe it was because of a jump start.
Indonesia themselves, they're running in 12th place at the moment. And Ananda Mikkola trying to make the most of his circuit knowledge here, but hasn't managed to gain much in the last few laps. The next car up the road is the Netherlands.
Well, we see 44 laps to go, but we are now under the hour. We're under 59 minutes and 30 seconds. So it is a race that will be on time more than on distance, but with the lap speed of 1 minute 26.8 from Nico Hülkenberg. And should the track dry out, well, it's the lap times will drop.
Look at Germany.
Look at the way he throws that car on. There's the gap. It's up to, well, it's 5.5 seconds as he went across the start-finish line. It certainly looked to be that and maybe more. There's the distance. It's virtually three-quarters of the length of the straight. That's the advantage Nico Hülkenberg has pulled out in the space of two laps over Johnny Reid from New Zealand. Now we've got Robbie Kerr beginning to make a little bit of impression and still under pressure from South Africa in fourth place.
The last lap by Team Germany, a 1:26.8. Everybody else, the best they can do is a 1:28.8. Again, it's 2 seconds faster than anyone else. France and Malaysia still engaged in a tussle for fifth place, but Malaysia not close enough to the white, blue and red of Team France. And Nicolas Lapierre, he's not likely to win unless something big happens in the pit stops. But remember, there's a long way to go in this race.
Well, that is the view from Malaysia, now really under the rear wing of France. Alex Chung, a driver who struggled in the first part of the wet race in Malaysia because of... And he's got a damage. I think that front wing in his car is damaged. The right-hand element of the wing looks to me as if he may have had contact with another car. It may be... No, it doesn't.
He's down the inside, John. He's through. Malaysia takes the place from Team France. And Alex Chung moves up into fifth position.
Just there was an illusion as the car came into sight. It looked as if it was damaged. It is not. Alex Chung has got a fully fit race car. He's made up that one position, now into fifth place, and more points for Malaysia.
A little bit wide through the first part of turn 10, but he's looking for the straight exit. Drive through, but it's irrelevant. Lebanon has a damaged car, surely.
Well, it looks like the right front, left, rear are the damage on the car, whether that's a puncture or whether it looks to be more as if it's damaged suspension.
Eight laps have been completed, so they're allowed to make their prescribed pit stop now. So obviously damage on the car, but the pit lane window has opened up. This is how Malaysia got past France.
Yes, a good run up into the turns. I think this is up into turn 9, 8 and 9. So Lapierre absolutely correct and fair. He did not try to block the Malaysia pass. He knew that he had a car behind him that was capable of running quicker. It was inevitable it would happen sooner if not later.
It looks as though it's all over for Lebanon. The signal's being given. Sorry,
a damaged rear suspension. The car came in. You could see the right front was up in the air. The left front was doing funny things as well. So there must have been contact some point with Malaysia or with Indonesia. With the Lebanon.
So poor old Basil Chaban's out of the race, but this guy, Nico Hülkenberg, is once again streaking ahead by up to 2 seconds a lap. Although Malaysia put in a pretty quick lap, only a second and a half off Germany on that last lap. The margin that Hülkenberg has here is truly remarkable. Johnny Reid running in a solid second. I mean, the important thing from New Zealand's point of view is they've got to collect points. They didn't want to gamble too much.
Whoa, and that shows you never relax. That's the slick part of the exit of turn 11, and Johnny Reid's back of his car just snapped into an oversteer.
Germany into the 125s now. He's making them look silly here. That's 2.5 seconds again faster than most of the others.
And the gap now up to over 10 seconds in the space of four laps. I mean, you talk about remarkable wet weather driving. We had an example of what Nico Hülkenberg is all about in Malaysia. We are now getting a masterclass. I mean, you've got to talk at the levels of people, wet weather drivers that I've known, Ayrton Senna, and of course Michael Schumacher, to get a drive of this quality from this young German.
Now, Italy is engaged in a battle with Canada and the Netherlands here. This is all over 9th, 10th and 11th places, just inside the points. Well, Netherlands would like to be inside the points because they're one position outside at the moment. Sean McIntosh drives for Canada this weekend. Enrico Tocicello for Italy. He looked a bit wide through first corner. And it's Jérôme Bleekemolen, the Dutch regular driver, who's at the wheel of the bright orange machine. He's the one who's hunting Canada down as they come through turn 3.
So we run into turn 3. There we look at Brazil there into the pits. Now they're making an early stop for wet weather tyres, which they've taken off, putting a new set on. And they're allowed to do that from lap 8 on. We're into lap 9. And they open the pit stop window at the earliest opportunity to give them a fresh set of wet weather tyres.
Interesting to come in so early because they're obviously banking on it staying wet throughout the rest of this race. I guess that's pretty likely, but you just never know. I would think other teams might leave it to later in the pit stop window before they make their decision on when to make the pit stop.
Well, there was no obvious reason to come at this point, but obviously the team feel that that's what they want to do, is this battle again with Canada and the Netherlands for 10th place, running just behind Enrico Tocchicella for Italy.
Yeah, he's just broken away a bit, but the Dutch car, that bit closer to Canada, and Europe Lekamolen is going for the move down the inside.
He's done it, he's got it, a good move, a courageous move, well calculated. Sean McIntosh for Canada did put the squeeze on, but Lekamolen was sufficiently far up low. Canada's going into the pits.
Yeah, he's coming in for the early pit stop here, so Canada rolling the dice and deciding to go for the early stop rather than the later. They may be going for different
France
tire pressures.
France in as well, so France have dived in just ahead of Canada, and look at the pit crew. Absolutely, a pit lane sodden, let alone the racetrack. So,
now remember how different tyre pressures could completely alter a car's handling. Mexico's in.
And I wonder whether they're going to do work on the car aside from just altering tyre pressures as Canada comes to a standstill. So, the pit lane from being relatively quiet at the late 8-lap point is now becoming a very busy racetrack.
Remember, the guys have to stand in the pit garage until the car has stopped in front of them. Then they can run out and affect the tyre change. That looked pretty good for Team Mexico as they come out to 30.
Well, they come out ahead of Canada.
Yep,
they were ahead of Canada on the road, but they're so when Alan van der Merwe battling now for third place with Robbie Kerr, Team GBR. Will one of these two dive off at the last minute and make it into the pit lane? Are they going to stay out? Both? Yes, both stay out.
I could just see that Australia have been into the pits as well. They are well back, though. They had a problem in the first couple of laps, so they're not featuring in the race at the moment. And it's, you could just see Australia ahead of them as these guys come in to turns one and two.
And that will be a problem because they will not want that car to come into play when there's a battle going on for position. Of course, visibility, rearward visibility. Oh, Czech replay. This is Yaroslav Yanis, Czech Republic, going plowing the fields and scattering everything on the racetrack. There, that battle now getting closer between Great Britain and South Africa.
Alan van der Merwe is driving a fine race here at the moment.
At this part of racetrack, van der Merwe clearly had an advantage on the opening lap. And again, right now under the rear wing, watch for a move on Team GBR from South Africa.
And also, Malaysia's catching in the background. This battle for third, again, Robbie Kerr, Great Britain, manages to defend his position currently. But behind them, Malaysia's lapping quicker than these two and is beginning to close up.
Yeah, but I think that the South Africa car clearly is a better car in these conditions. Van der Merwe pulls up alongside Robbie Kerr. Can he get down the inside? Kerr has to concede into turn eight. And Robbie Kerr tries to come back, but he's wrong-footed and he cannot get it done. He was prepared to have a go going into turn seven. He couldn't get it done. Van der Merwe was in the right position, got the pass. Now it's all up to Robbie Kerr. Can he do the same again but pay the compliment as they come into turn 10? No.
So van der Merwe slithering his way through turns 10 and 11. What a debut this is for Alan van der Merwe for South Africa. He's now up into third place, but both of them have to keep a wary eye on Team Malaysia. Alex Jung lapping quickly behind.
And clearly you can see South Africa, how much they've pulled out once they have gotten ahead of Team GBR. The gap already, well, just about a second. We see Germany preparing for their one and only pit stop of the afternoon, assuming it doesn't go dry.
The other problem for South Africa is that Australia's ahead of him on the road and has come out of the pits and is going actually very quickly. It's going to be quite difficult to put himself in a position perhaps to overtake
it. The problem is for Australia, they are obliged to get out of the way of South Africa because they are one lap in effect down. No matter the pace that you're running at, if you get waved yellow flags, you are required to get out of the way. Here's a battle going on. Owen McIntosh and Salvador Duran got so close together.
And he still hasn't given up the chance to get past. They have both had their pit stops, these guys, remember. And so they're way down the order at the moment. But when it all shakes itself out, when everyone else has stopped, then they could still be battling, certainly in the points. They'd both be just inside the top 10, I would say, after they're settled. And Sean McIntosh now alongside, almost touching onto the straight.
And that was a courageous move and a well-judged move by both drivers. They gave each other sufficient room to work, particularly McIntosh on the inside. Hard to hold the current, but Mexico comes back, goes down the outside, coming into turn one, but Canada's got the position, and I would say the corner.
And indeed, Canada set the fastest mid-sector time of anybody on that last lap. So he's flying now. He's made his pit stop. Battle here between Great Britain for fourth with Malaysia. And Alex Jung has caught right up to the back of the British car. Almost got alongside for a moment, but has had to settle back into the slipstream.
The trouble was he was in the wrong part of the racetrack. He needed to be in the inside, as Canada were, one lap ago. So Robbie Kerr also now finding himself under pressure, having lost one position one lap ago, is under threat to lose yet another. Drop from fourth to Alex Young in Malaysia in fifth place.
Well, Alex Young does seem to revel in these conditions when the car's right, as it was in the latter stages in Malaysia, and it seems to be right in the early stages here in Indonesia.
37 laps or 50 minutes precisely until this race comes to a conclusion.
Down towards turn four then. Can Malaysia find a little bit more traction out of this one? They've also got the Brazilian car to get past. Brazil has been into the pits, and so he's slightly out of sequence with these two guys, and Robbie Kerr's going to have to try and get past him and keep an eye on his mirrors.
He will indeed, and the trouble is that Brazil is running 2 seconds a lap slower than these two cars who are battling over that fourth position. Robbie Kerr holds it. Alex Jung wants it.
Yeah, he does. What a great view. How close can you get? And no, the position is covered by Great Britain. Malaysia thought about trying to go for it down the inside.
Oh,
now
he's going
down. Outside.
Robbie Kerr opens the door, and Alex Jung, he read it. He knew what Robbie Kerr was going to do. Robbie moved to the right to get the line through the corner. And of course, Alex Jung plonked his car right and truly in the middle of that corner. Robbie Kerr was, well, he had no choice to back off, and he's lost one more place, down to fifth for Team GBR.
Team Malaysia now fourth. Germany still leads this race from New Zealand in second place, South Africa in third. Now it's Malaysia in fourth, Great Britain in fifth, and struggling in these conditions. The Netherlands, by the way, not having stopped yet, have now moved up into sixth place ahead of Italy, Ireland, China and Indonesia. But that's because some of the other guys who were in the top 10 have already made an early pit stop.
So Germany bringing its wheels back into the garage in anticipation. Now, we don't know whether they're going to do it in the next lap or two. They're certainly indicating that as we go on lap 15 right now, they may choose to come in as we look at New Zealand as well, preparing to make a pit stop.
Yeah, so it's going to be crucial times coming up here for the lead cars for Germany, who's already coming up behind USA, who must have made their pit stop. Yes, they have. USA currently running in 14th position, but still a lot of cars ahead of them to stop.
Watch for Germany to peel off as we get Indonesia having a drive through. It's a tire change, so there's the helmet camera. It goes on left front wheel, wheel nut off, wheel off. That'll be removed by a corner worker. New wheel goes on. Make sure you return the way the gun operates, back on again. Good stop for Indonesia.
Yeah, well, certainly good on that wheel. How was it on the rest of it? Oh, no, look, they've got problems at the back, John. The wheels are spinning. Now, finally, he gets going, does he?
He stalled it. He anticipated what was going to happen. So now he's going to sit there while the air starter is once again installed. He can't get it detached from the cradle that it sits in. In the meantime, we're still waiting for Germany as New Zealand in Johnny Reid running in second place, the first of the leading cars to make it in the pit lane.
And I tell you what, we saw Germany setting a blistering pace early on, but both Canada and the United States, having made their pit stops, are now getting down to the sort of times that Nico Hülkenberg's been doing. Down into the 1 minute 25s, we're going to see some changes. Indonesia, look how long the stop was.
So that's more important. Let's see what happens in New Zealand. They've got to get a clean, quick stop. They are capable of winning this race. It only would take one little error on the part of the driver or in the pit stop where the wheel change does not go smoothly. That's a good stop from New Zealand. What does it stop the clock at as he goes out? 34.8.
Definitely one of the quickest we've seen. The Netherlands ahead of him has not yet stopped. Let's just see behind. Ireland, well, up there in seventh, but they haven't stopped yet. And China in eighth place. France in ninth, having made their stop, and others now, Switzerland, for example, coming in.
Yes, and Italy in the pit lane as well. But this is where the whole complexion of this race can change, because the leading cars, having made pit stops, will be going back out into the field, most of which have made stops, but there'll be those that are waiting later. And of course, then the difficulty becomes getting past those cars.
Italy in, but a new fastest lap by Canada. Sean McIntosh has just set a 125.5. That's faster than Germany has gone in this race so far. And suddenly the Canadian car is alive and moving up the order. 13th at the moment, but he's got other cars still to make their pit stops. Away goes Italy, away goes Switzerland. The Italian stop, certainly not as quick as the one we saw a moment ago for New Zealand. Let's see how the Swiss stop looks.
Well, for Canada, they're some 6.5 seconds behind the USA and lapping about a second a lap quicker. Switzerland, Neil Jani gets back on the front. You must stay to the left of that line. You see, that's the pit lane exit line until you get into turn one.
Came out just about with Great Britain there as he rejoins the track, but Great Britain yet to make their pit stop, of course. You know, USA, Czech Republic, Germany's got himself in a bit of traffic here.
Yes, this is an opportunity. They want to bring Nico Hülkenberg in. He's got a 36 and a half second advantage over Malaysia as South Africa's in the pits. 36 and a half second advantage over Malaysia, who are now in second. South Africa was third. They've gone into the pits. So is that a quick change or is that a good change? It doesn't look particularly quick to us, considering what we've seen from New Zealand. 34.8 for New Zealand, 40.9. 6 seconds slower for South Africa.
Now Ireland's in the pit. We'll see whether all their practice this weekend has been effective. But South Africa definitely lost some time there, and that'll hurt Alan van der Merwe in his attempts to get a podium finish here today. Germany's just coming in. I was just about to say, Germany in. Crucial pit stop here, coming up for race leader Nico Hülkenberg.
So make your way down at 60 kilometres per hour. It seems interminable to the time you get to your pit box. Splashes in, not particularly well placed.
Ireland still there. Ireland have a problem, John, in the pits, because they're still in the pit lane. They shouldn't still be there.
They may well have a problem, but I think some of the work may be done to try and maybe give them a better car. As Ireland now leaves the pit lane, certainly that length of time would not be normal for a wheel change.
Bit slow on that left rear, but they get him away. It's not the fastest stop of the day. It should be enough, though, for him to comfortably retain his lead.
Yes, it is about 3 seconds down on the sister team, New Zealand. Nevertheless, Nico Hülkenberg, when all the pit stops finalise and shake out, as we've got Team GBR in the pits as well. Johnny Reid in the forward, and he's got an opportunity. He's got a pretty clear road ahead of him to put in some good work.
New Zealand, therefore, you can see how far back he is because Germany's already out and round on its first lap. Great Britain in. Great Britain into the pits. Now, have they got a better setup for this car? The tyres may be repressured. Perhaps it'll be happier in the second half.
I think it's not that. I think there's other problems. They haven't really gone for the setup to suit the conditions. In the meantime, New Zealand out on their new set of tyres, 125.8. Everybody in the leading bunch is getting down to those middle 1 minute 25s we saw first from Germany, then from Canada.
So Great Britain does come out back behind South Africa. South Africa and USA are having a bit of a dice here at the moment. And that could end up being for about fourth or fifth place once we've seen a few more pit stops. Malaysia,
They're ready to come in now. They're going to bring him in from second place. The gap down to 30 seconds. But of course, Germany having made that pit stop, it's all somewhat irrelevant. We'll know at the end of this next lap where Germany is in relation to Great Britain, who are now in the pit lane, but principally to New Zealand. So it'll be Germany and New Zealand. Alex Jung stays out another lap, doesn't come in, and he's got Yaroslav running behind for the Czech Republic.
That's right, China have made a pit stop just now as well, so they're back on their way again. They're one of the later teams to stop. The Netherlands are also waiting quite late in this race before they make their stop. Otherwise, pretty much everybody has stopped, and Germany are still very much in command of this race.
Alex Jung leads for the first time, and maybe the only time this afternoon. He is yet to make a pit stop. He's the last of the front runners. In the meantime, New Zealand has done another stunning lap. In fact, the fastest lap of the race to date, 124.7559. And Johnny Reid, he thinks he has a chance of reclaiming the lead of this race, bearing in mind that the pit stop for Germany was some 4 seconds slower than that of New Zealand.
Let's take a look at Germany. What's been going on? Hülkenberg has been off.
And that's the reason why.
And did he manage to get back on without losing much time? How will this affect things? Is he still ahead of New Zealand, or did he lose the place? I think he's still in front. I think, although Malaysia lead, we're waiting for them to stop. I think Germany is still ahead of New Zealand, but there's a scare for the team.
And you can see the faces of the team support group and Nico Hülkenberg, team management David Sears, looking at the monitors as we once again go on board with Alex Jung, still the leading car yet to make his stop.
Yeah, are we going to see him in this lap? Yanis is looking as quick as Alex Jung. Out of the final corner, does he come in?
He's in this time, yes,
yeah.
He is.
He's cutting across. Yanis was trying to get the toe off the back of the car for as long as possible, but he's already been into the pit lane, and the Czech Republic don't look as though they're going to be scoring that well. So we will wait to see when Germany comes around how much time Germany lost to New Zealand.
He did a 132.9. He, in effect, lost the best part of 8 seconds.
He just came round, though. He's still ahead of New Zealand. We'll count the gap as Malaysia make this important stop. Let's see whether they get it safely back on its way.
At 9.8 seconds is the gap between Germany and New Zealand, and that was an 8-second loss for Nico Hülkenberg when he went off down to turn four.
So where does this bring Malaysia out with regard to countries like France, USA and Great Britain? This is the key. That's France just heading into the first corner.
And USA is coming through as well, but Malaysia may get out. USA coming down now. He's going to get the corner, so the USA will retain that position.
But he's going to get out ahead of Great Britain. I think he'll stay ahead of Great Britain. USA, John, have done really well with their pit stop because they've managed to move Phil Giebler back up the order. He's now ahead. Oh, and here comes Kerr to claim his place back. Yeah, because Malaysia not yet up to speed.
Well, we'll see what happens, because Malaysia was very emphatic in getting past Team GBR a number of laps ago. And Robbie Kerr, we think, has got a car which is not necessarily the ultimate wet weather car.
Behind them, South Africa and Canada were having a big old tussle for eighth place there. Nothing to choose between those two cars as well. Australia's now up to 11th, so they've made good progress with an early pit stop. Team Germany, still race leader. As you say, he lost a bit of his advantage, but he's still up there. And now that Malaysia's made the pit stop, he'll be the clear leader. Again, keep an eye on his lap times. Let's see how quickly he's going.
1:27.8. And I suspect that the team have been on the radio and telling him to calm down. You don't need to do the pace you're doing. You've got control of this race. But behind, there we see New Zealand coming out from under the spray, and that's of Indonesia. So he doesn't get it done. Indonesia still stays ahead of Johnny Reid going into turn one.
He was a second faster on that lap. Johnny Reid turning the tables. He's quicker than Germany at the moment.
But the problem for Johnny Reid is that he's got a lap car ahead of him. That's Indonesia. So he's going to ball. He's going to struggle to find a way past Nando Mikkola unless he gets waved blue flags.
France now in third place. USA is fifth, because we're waiting for the Netherlands to come in, although they have just come in. USA will therefore move up to fourth, Great Britain fifth, and Malaysia sixth.
And Malaysia dropping back from the tail of Team GBR, as Canada, as Sean McIntosh running on a 1:28.2.
Slick tyres on the touch car.
Absolutely mad, in my opinion.
Will he get out of the pits, let alone go anywhere else?
Well, I tell you what, the conditions are still too wet, in my opinion, and I do not see how this racetrack can dry up. We saw Italy do something similar back at Malaysia 2 weekends ago. It took Enrico Tocchicella the best part of 10 laps to even get to be capable of matching a wet weather time. And for Jeroen Blekemolen, well, Holland, the land of dikes and water, I suppose you might say he's familiar with wet tracks, but it's a big, big ask of the Dutchman.
And it looks as though Australia may well be going for the same gamble. This is fascinating stuff. And you can see how much people are moving offline at the moment to try and cool those tyres. Robbie Kerr just did a very
Australia
quick lap.
In.
Yeah, Australia.
And other slicks going on. They are brand new slicks as well for Ryan Briscoe. So this is a real toss the dice and hope that it turns up the right way for both the Netherlands and for Australia.
Now, what does New Zealand and Germany do? Do they call their guys in? The gap has come down on that last lap. New Zealand 6.8 seconds behind Germany.
It's all irrelevant. What you have to watch for are the lap times of Australia and of the Netherlands. Once they get within about 3 seconds of a wet weather time, then you've got to come in, and that's the latest you can afford to do. So it is up now to the team manager, in conjunction with the driver, to work out, can you handle slicks at this stage? The back of the circuit is clearly beginning to dry. You can see the beginning of a dry line coming up into turn six. Nico Hülkenberg, remember, on wet weather tyres. How long will it take before the switchover occurs? Well, Germany's last lap was a 1:27. New Zealand's a 1:25. France's a 1:26. Watch for the Netherlands, watch for Australia to see what they do on their first flying laps.
37 and a half minutes remain in this race. That's a long way to go still. And what the Netherlands did there was to try and use their one and only pit stop. That's what they're hoping for, at least, if it doesn't rain again, to go on to slicks early and just tell him to stay out there. But New Zealand is definitely going quicker now than Germany. So it's been a complete reversal in fortunes with the tyres that they've put on at the pit stop. Great Britain again now right up behind USA.
It's a totally different car. Car's been transformed. And this set of tyres may well, for whatever reason, you mentioned tyre pressures, certainly something has transformed Team GBR's car. And the opposite has happened to Malaysia. They're falling away.
2 seconds faster New Zealand than Germany. Would you believe it? In the early part of the race, Germany was 2 seconds a lap quicker than New Zealand. Now it's completely the other way around. New Zealand's catching the race leader, the gap down to 4.7.
And this car, Team GBR, is catching all of them, because the last lap for Team GB was a 1:24, just going across the line at 1:25. And of course, that's the benefit of a brand new set of tyres.
But the new mid-sector fastest time by the Netherlands.
Netherlands. But Team Netherlands are under investigation.
Would you believe it? On our timing panels, it says Team Netherlands under investigation. That might be for speeding in pit lane. It might be something like that. But he's just gone quickest in the mid-sector. The slick tyres are working already.
So wait and see what the first full lap on a set of slicks is all about. So this will be an indication to everyone in the pit lane. They'll watch their monitors. And the Netherlands time is a 1:27.5. So you're going to have to make a second stop if you are one of those leading group of cars, because the pace that the Netherlands are running at now is within a second, maybe 2 seconds to the outside of what a wet weather tyre time's all about.
Oh,
spinning in the pit lane.
Canada spinning in the pit lane. Would you believe it? and Malaysia getting out. Now, look, Malaysia have made an early stop.
On slicks, that's why he spun. He hit a puddle. He aquaplaned under par. Remember, he's on the speed limit button. He shouldn't be doing more than 60 kilometres per hour. But clearly, one wheel suddenly spun up, and that threw the car sideways. And luckily, no problem. But indications that maybe the racetrack's not dangerous, but the pit lane certainly is. There he is, spins the wheels up. Watch for the puddle, and suddenly there she snaps around as he puts a little bit of right-hand lockdown. And luckily, the guys in the Brazil garage, they're there, or South Africa, in fact, yeah, to push him back to safety. And Sean McIntosh, well, did he ever get a wake-up call? Robbie Kerr, and look, Australia. So Australia on slicks, remember, Robbie Kerr still on wets, fighting with America, Team USA.
Oh, this is great stuff. This is the fourth position now between USA and Great Britain with this rejuvenated car. Robbie Kerr is on the attack. We know how well he can race, and he'll bide his time until he can find the opportunity to get past Phil Keebler.
The Australia car nowhere near as quick on its slicks as the Netherlands car, some 2 to 3 seconds a lap slower.
Well, that is interesting, and all the teams will be keeping a close eye on the progress of those cars on slicks. Who is the next to stop? USA are ready.
Well, they've got their tyres in those tyre blankets. We're looking also to see whether South Africa, they're going to make the same choices.
South Africa currently running in a strong sixth place ahead of the Netherlands seventh, of course, going quickly on their slicks. And then Italy eighth, Czech Republic are up to ninth now. Switzerland have gained as
Ireland back in. I suspect that's in for, well,
slick tyres, presumably.
Truthfully, the problems Ireland have had, I wouldn't even want to say it was for slick tyres. I think slick tyres are probably the last of their problems.
11th at the moment, John, though.
They're putting slicks on, I think. But here's a bunch of cars. Brazil running ahead on track, but of course behind in position. And America trying to force its way through turn to 11.
Did it, but Great Britain also had a good run off the corner.
Indeed, and that's given Robbie Kerr every opportunity. Has he got any power boost left, Great Britain? No, he hasn't. He's used all his power boost. Defence from a USA down the inside. Robbie Kerr trying to go down the long way.
Oh, he gets sideways on the line.
Robbie, you watch those white lines. You've been flirting with them all afternoon, and that could be just the last warning you're going to get.
USA holds on to the position, but Robbie Kerr really flirted with disaster that time. Well saved, Robbie Kerr, but my goodness, it nearly went off. And he
does it again into turn three.
Yeah, he's
determined. You cannot afford to take those risks.
He's on the white line just about everywhere, and that's not good plan in these conditions at all. But he's so frustrated. Look how they're right with France. France running in third place, and these guys are catching France.
They're running a second a lap quicker than France, but of course, once they all begin to close up, they'll drop back to the pace of France. Nicolas Lapierre has got the brains and the intelligence to know that he can control the pace of the two cars. Bear in mind that they're battling each other before they even get a chance to battle France.
And meanwhile, up front, New Zealand are now just 1.8 seconds behind Germany. New Zealand flying in the second half of this race. And look at the battle. John, Germany and New Zealand absolutely together again.
1.2 seconds as they went across the line. That was in to turn. That was coming across the top, but it's just literally a few seconds ago. So Johnny Reed has run down his young German colleague, who's certainly on this set of tyres, struggled to find the grip, the pace that he had on the initial run.
It's amazing how much the tyres make a difference. I've never seen it quite so graphically illustrated than in the last two races. France and USA with Great Britain. This is three cars now racing for third.
And Robbie Kerr wisely has chosen to drop back just to regroup, just focus. He's very, very aggressive the way he throws the car into turn two. Really, really leans on the back wheel of the car.
Mexico are not part of this game, so I wonder how they might affect things. Nicolas Lapierre for France has got his mirrors being filled up with the United States and Great Britain, all for a possible podium
spot. Here we go.
And this is the battle for the lead between Germany and New Zealand.
And they come up into, this is turn eight and nine, and this is the quicker of the two S's around the back. You can see that Team New Zealand's car were able to run much quicker than Team Germany. And I just wonder whether Germany or New Zealand will take this opportunity. And he goes alongside into turn 10. Johnny Reed dives down the inside. Nico Hülkenberg can afford to run around the outside, but he's had to concede. He's lost the lead that he regained early in this lap to, or early in this race, to his team colleague, Johnny Reed.
So, a real reversal in fortunes, and the man who started on pole lost the lead to Team Germany, now reclaims the top spot once again, and Germany back into second place. These guys are well ahead of third place France, who are still trying to defend from USA. This was how he did it.
Yes, he got in up the inside, he took control. Nico Hülkenberg really just has not got the grip on this set of tyres to defend that situation. He wisely let New Zealand go, and it may well be that they'll both make further trips into the pit lane to go on to dry weather tyres. Still Mexico, as Canada goes on those slick tyres, that's the danger. You just, bumping. Robbie Kerr collides with Mexico. That's not for position, that's to get him out of the way.
But both Kerr and USA are past France. It's completely changed. Robbie Kerr for Great Britain is now third. France back to fifth because USA here has also got past them. Phil Keebler now trying to get past Mexico.
Well, these two nations, USA and Great Britain, were clearly quicker than France. We didn't see where that pass did occur, but it occurred, and then Robbie Kerr had to go a little bit rock ape to get past Mexico. Salvador Duran wasn't about to give way into turn one, so a little bit of a tap, a love tap on that left front, right front wheel, and job done.
Great Britain some 22 seconds behind the race leaders, New Zealand and Germany, but pulling away quickly here from Team USA. Kerr's car really working, as we said earlier on, but he's got to keep those wet tyres as cool as possible.
And just watch the way the USA stays as wide on the left part of the track, looking at us right to him, to ensure that he keeps those wet weather tyres at operational temperature. Wet weather tyres, ultimately, if they get too hot, they will start to deteriorate. South Africa in, and a wet set of slick tyres in wet conditions as South Africa go out of the pits.
Now, the Netherlands, which was the first one to put its slick tyres on.
Still a long way to go, 23 laps, or just under 30 minutes. So this racetrack, assuming we don't see any more rain, will switch gradually over to being a slick tyre track.
But he hasn't actually set a fastest lap overall, although he put in that very quick second sector a while ago. It still hasn't become the fact that a car on slicks is quicker, but Great Britain's in, John. Great Britain's going to go putting on slicks now.
I just wonder the wisdom of doing that. Robbie Kerr was so quick on this particular set of tyres, so they take the wets off, the dries are sitting beside. So is this the decision that will win the race the first time for Team GBR? Or is it a call that's just a lap or two too early?
I think that New Zealand and Germany are taking the gamble that it'll rain again. I'm not seeing any sign of that just yet, but it's still pretty cloudy overhead. Great Britain, though, going for the slick tyre option.
Well, I think the reason why Germany and New Zealand are hanging out is because it's only on the last lap that we've seen a time from this car, the orange car of the Netherlands, beginning to approach that of the cars that are on wet weather tyres. Robbie Kerr comes out directly behind the Netherlands, and that will be seventh place for Team GBR on slicks. Robbie Kerr has got to be very careful in this outlap. He can't just charge up to the back of the New Zealand car. They've been on the Netherlands car. They've been on slicks for some 8 or 9 laps. They know the feel of the car. They know the parts of the racetrack where he can drive the car.
That's right, but it's good opportunity.
You can see there,
to follow him.
Out of turn four into five, the track is virtually a drying line.
So the Netherlands up to sixth place now on their slick tyres, sixth position, but remember, they're still under investigation.
Robbie Kerr's oversteering as he came through turn six as Germany getting ready for Nico Hülkenberg. He's 5 seconds now behind Johnny Reid from New Zealand, and that is what a switch in performance from where we saw the start of this event.
Well, this race is still alive, isn't it? France now into the pits to come in from fourth to put their slick tyres on. It's got to be done, surely. 27 minutes still to go in the race.
Both New Zealand and Germany must, I think, at this opportunity come in, because if they throw the advantage to Team GBR, depending on what Robbie Kerr can do on his first full flying lap, that will clearly be one lap or two or three too late.
So is it a clean stop? They've got the new slicks on, brand new slicks, not even scrubbed slicks going on the car.
25.743 for the Netherlands on their last lap. So there, the battle for fifth place between Team GBR and Team Netherlands. Robbie Kerr's lap, we have to get a full lap. He's only completed that first flying lap. So France out on slicks. We're now seeing the best part of half the field transferring over to slicks as he just blocks off Jaroslav Janis in the Czech Republic. Robbie Kerr being cautious, he hasn't been able to put a move or attempt anything on the Netherlands yet.
Not yet, but play it patiently, Robbie. This could end up being the lead battle, because with the cars ahead of them all on wet tyres, France now behind them, they've been into the pits. It could well be. Germany's in. Germany, yes, into the pits from second position.
I was going to say, suddenly Germany's dropped to 13.8 seconds behind New Zealand. That's the reason why he was coming in the pit lane. So we need again another 3 laps for this whole situation to sort itself out as Germany gets the wheels off. And let's hope it's a clean stop for both New Zealand and Germany, that this race is actually won on the racetrack and not a matter of winning in the pit lane. So we have to keep an eye.
Just look at the amount of water around in the pit lane, though. He's got to be careful.
It's a problem. Is it a problem on the left rear? There is a problem.
There is a problem.
He's lost the nut. He's lost the wheel nut. It's under the car.
Yeah, he lost the wheel now.
Oh, this is all over for Germany. They will be lucky to recover from this, certainly in terms of getting on the winner's podium, because that was a long stop. The wheel nut dropped out of the gun. It rolled under the car. The guy on the left rear could not feel where that nut was.
But he's out ahead of the Netherlands and Great Britain. That is crucial, that they got him out ahead of these two cars on the slick tyres. If the track continues to dry off, he still could be in good shape, and still it's frustration for Great Britain. Held up, he would feel behind the Netherlands.
Well, I would say that it's a race for position on the track. He's holding him up, but that's a race for that. You can do nothing about it. Robbie Kerr again on the grass. Will somebody put on the radio to Robbie Kerr that the grass is not part of the racetrack?
But he's alongside, and I think he's got the place now. Oh, he's brave, is that Robbie Kerr, but he does.
He is taking risks.
He is.
How many times? Four times in the last 10 laps have we seen him put the left rear wheel onto the grass? You can get away with it. You get away with it. Well, let's look again and see where he is. You can see the mud being chucked up, but he gets the switch back. As the Netherlands goes out wide, Robbie Kerr goes up at the inside, gets sufficiently alongside the Netherlands for the Netherlands to concede. It was inevitable that Robbie Kerr was going to get past, but it was a question of where, and a brave, brave move into turn three and four.
New Zealand continues to lead and has just set a fastest lap on his wet tyres. That's how quick New Zealand's still going. His wet tyres are working perfectly. Johnny Reid, fastest on that last lap. He's flying along. He doesn't need to stop for slicks yet.
No, and his tyres are looking still pretty good. There's a bit of, let's say, the feathering, the tread blocks are beginning to show signs of wear as New Zealand are looking at the monitors there, calculating at which point they've got a 26.7 second advantage over Team USA, the first car on slicks, with Germany behind, Great Britain, Netherlands, France, and then the Czech Republic as well. The Czech Republic, of course, one of the few cars that has yet to pit.
So he's got to keep those tyres as cool as possible, but he's still lapping fast at the moment. The tyres show no strain, really. He's got the Brazilian car way ahead, a 125 last time around, but a new fastest lap for a car on slicks. At last, it's France who've just set the fastest lap. They're in sixth position currently, but Lapierre, the quickest car now out there.
So looking at Team USA, so I suspect that the New Zealand team must, as the USA, again, a set of tyres, but the Team New Zealand, even though they're running in the 125s, the low 25s, even high 124s, have got to consider now a pit stop.
Well, this is a real topsy-turvy race, and currently New Zealand lead from the United States there in second place. Germany then in third, Great Britain fourth, fifth place for the Netherlands, but sixth place, this car, right behind the Netherlands, and the fastest car on circuit.
Have they had the USA in for a stop for slicks? I don't believe they've been in once, but whether that was for slicks or whether it was for a set of wet tyres, we need to check.
Yeah, no, they've only stopped for wet so far. So we're waiting to see USA come in and make a stop onto slicks if they decide to do that. But here we go, battle for fifth place coming up.
And Nicolas Lapierre is going to take it as he runs down into turn one. You can see the defence from the Netherlands goes one way now, it goes down, goes the long way around the outside. Has he got the momentum to take him past? He can go side by side in turn one, as long as there's no contact. There isn't. Great pass by Nicolas Lapierre.
Great stuff. Nicolas Lapierre takes France into fifth position. And that was a brave move around the outside at turn number one. And now New Zealand's in. Now, can they get back out in front of Germany in particular? If they have a clean stop, he should do that easily, because remember, Germany had a slow stop.
It did have a slow stop. The wheel nut fell out of the gun on the left rear, and that, of course, cost another 5 or 8 seconds. Spare nuts are carried by the gunman on any of those wheels, but he's got to pull it out of his pocket, put it into the gun, then get it all back onto the wheel. And all that was vital seconds for Nico Hülkenberg and Team Germany.
Team USA leads the race, but Team USA is now on wet tyres that have passed their best. Have they got a clean stop for New Zealand? Oh, magic stop for New Zealand, and this should retain the lead for Johnny Reid effectively, although USA are currently leading, and it depends how long they stay out there. But New Zealand will rejoin in second position, and we'll wait to see where Germany is. They're not even out of the last corner yet.
No, and we've got now 18 laps to go, or 21 minutes, so it is not going to go 18 laps. At best, it might go 16.
Germany's just crossed the line, some 54 seconds behind, so there's a big, big gap there. It's really now all about USA, and they can't possibly think they're going to stay on the wets throughout the rest of this race, can they?
No, they can't do that, but the lap time of Germany now running in third place behind the USA is 1:23.9. Fastest lap, 1:23.1 for Nicolas Lapierre of France. We still wait to see whether the Team USA is going to do the opposite to that they did. No, they're not. They're prepared for that team car to come into the pitch. They realise that the tyre, you can see that the tyre is feathering. So USA are going to be forced to make a pit stop to concede the second place they've held for a number of laps.
New Zealand back out on the slick tyres, and And Johnny Reid's just put in the fastest mid-sector time. That's remarkable from Johnny Reid.
Well, nice warm tyres, brand new tyres. You can do it. You've got the best grip from the tyre. As long as that Butter racetrack is sufficiently dry, it'll be other parts of the racetrack. It'll just take them a little minute or two to adapt to.
USA in from the lead of the race. Where will they be able to get back out again? That's the key question.
New Zealand across the line, back into the lead of this race.
And with a very healthy lead. You're looking at the clock ticking away now. Let's see where it stops. It's going to be a long time.
It's going to be 15, 16 seconds. Nico Hülkenberg comes out of the final turn 11. In fact, it's going to be nearer to 18 seconds, the advantage New Zealand enjoys over Team Germany.
19 seconds indeed, and USA back on their way. Where will USA rejoin? Behind Germany, behind Great Britain, behind France, but ahead of the Netherlands. So that will put them in fifth position.
But remember how stunning this man was in the Netherlands, in track conditions, probably marginally worse now than we're seeing. And again, challenge from France coming to Team GBR. Robbie Kerr under big threat from France, goes three wide, going into turn three.
These two raced against each other here at Central last year, and Lafayette was able to find a way past Kerr, and now he wants to do the same. They're racing here for fourth position, or there will be third position now that USA have made their stop. So this is for the final podium spot, and France wants it from Great Britain. Not going to go there, though.
No, you've got to be patient. France clearly is quicker of the two cars at this point. You see how much Kirby could use in the inside. That shows you the level of confidence that Nicolas Lapierre has got in his car and the levels of grip he's got on this racetrack. Making the way up now to turn eight and then into nine.
So, for the moment, Great Britain defends.
Robbie Kerr, be careful. You ran wide. You offered an opportunity for Nicolas Lapierre to get a run at you. It's difficult up into turn 10 because it's not the kind of corner you want to try and dive down the inside. We've seen it happen in the wet conditions. I think Lapierre's going to wait, try and do what he did to Robbie Kerr 1 year ago. Slides too much, loses the opportunity. The momentum went with that slide. Robbie Kerr goes wide. It's back to Nicolas Lapierre, side by side down the pit straight.
Here comes France then alongside Great Britain, and he's got the inside line for the first corner. This is for third place.
He's got ahead. He's got ahead of Team GBR.
Team France into third position.
Oh, oversteer in the middle of the corner. Robbie Kerr can come back. Can he get alongside into turn two? He's trying to find a way around. The momentum has gone back to GBR. Watch for GBR to make a pass down into turn three.
Great racing between these two experienced A1 GP campaigners. Can Robbie Kerr take the place back? No, Lapierre's on the inside. And unless he goes wide, then Kerr is going to have to settle into his slipstream once again. Third place now, France. Fourth for Great Britain. And fifth place for the United States. Sixth place for the Netherlands. Seventh for the Czech Republic. Eighth for Switzerland. Ninth for Malaysia. And tenth place for Team Canada. But it's New Zealand that continues to lead this race by a margin of just under 20 seconds.
And the battle between New Zealand and Germany, more now a battle of who will be the quicker of the two race cars on track. They're both lapping in the mid, 1 minute 23s. Germany marginally quicker, 1:23.3. New Zealand 1:23.5.
It's remarkable how this race has fluctuated and changed in the differing conditions. And now we've got about 17 and a half minutes still to go of this race, or 15 laps, whichever comes first. And that means there's still some time to go. Of course, you never know, we might get another rain shower before the end. That would stir things up.
1:22.9 for Nico Hülkenberg, and the gap down to 18.3 seconds. 15 laps to go, or 17 and a half minutes. It's very, very marginal, unless something happens that New Zealand, they cannot maintain the pace. New Zealand running in 1:24.1 on that last lap, 1.3 seconds behind Germany.
James Robinson, engineer for Team GBR. He's seen his man passed by France, and he's going to be a bit careful here to see whether he can stay ahead of USA, although USA not really catching on that last lap. Phil Giebler in a settled fifth place, doesn't seem to be much quicker, about the same sort of pace as Great Britain. The Netherlands then, the orange car of Jeroen Bleekemolen, running in sixth place. Czech Republic in seventh, so it's a good effort from Jaroslav Janis, rookie driver this weekend. He's stayed out of trouble so far and is inside the points. Neil Jani for Switzerland's also inside the points, and Canada in tenth. But the last lap around, very rapid for Team Germany, and we'll have to see whether he's going to be able to close up the gap to New Zealand. Fastest lap of the race has just gone to Italy.
Yes, indeed, 22.759 as we see Tuca Rocha for Brazil drive off the track. He seems to like that part of racetrack. He's been off there many times over practice and in the race. Look, drives into the gravel and bumps his way through it and scoops a hole under floors worth and a bit of muck as well back onto the racetrack and deposits it for the next car up.
Yeah, he's been off there a few times, as you say. Germany across the line again, another quick lap. Again, he's gained about a second on New Zealand, but New Zealand don't need to panic. And the worst thing that Johnny Reid could do now is react.
Oh, Robbie Kerr again, that turn in oversteer into turn one again, flirts with the curve on the grass on the outside of turn one. Watch as he comes through two. Robbie Kerr clearly has got a car where he's battling with the back end grip. He is having to struggle, particularly under braking and entry into corners.
Yeah, but he still runs it onto the white line, doesn't he? And it's interesting how much road he uses going into these corners. Lapierre uses a lot coming out, as you can see.
Well, the key, I think, is to use it on the exit rather than the entry. You can get into a lot of trouble on the entry. You get into a lot less trouble on the exit. Team Netherlands under investigation now as well.
No, it's not that I was looking at, actually. It was the fact that France have just gone fastest lap again for Team France. So they really are flying here in these conditions. They are some 6 seconds behind Germany. There's the gap, 5.7, in fact, last time through the checkpoint. And France might have a chance of closing up on Team Germany before the end of the race. Both of them are gaining a little bit on race leader New Zealand.
Well, Nico Hülkenberg still running in second place. The gap between New Zealand and New Zealand and Germany is now stabilised, both doing the same lap time on the last lap. The gap down to 16 and a half seconds, 13 laps to go, or 15 minutes. That's all we've got left of this race here, the feature race in Central.
Yeah, fantastic race. Somebody else coming into the pits there, watching France come through at the moment. And I think it might have been Switzerland. I think they've left it very late, actually, to go onto their slick tyres, quite possibly. France continuing then, and with that fastest lap to Italy. Italy are currently running in 11th place, just outside the points. They're some 3 seconds behind Canada.
I mean, where did Italy find that lap? 1 minute 21.8, and that's just about a second quicker than pretty much everybody else. So Germany now doing a 22.0, so Germany getting down to that pace that Italy did. But where that lap from Italy came from, we didn't see it. We didn't know about it until it popped up on our timing and scoring screens.
It was Pakistan who came into the pits just now, my mistake, rather than Switzerland. So they've gone for the late call onto slick tyres, which are sensible. And France there still running in a strong third place. France and Germany that little bit quicker than the race leader New Zealand, but New Zealand having this pretty much under control so far. It's right on board with Nicolas Lapierre as he tries to balance 520 horsepower, and then in these conditions, even as the track dries out, it's not easy.
I bet you he wished he had 530 horsepower, because that would give him an advantage over the entire field. Of course, you get 550 with power boost, but pretty much everybody has used. In fact, well, New Zealand's used 4, Germany's used 3, and France have used 4. So they've all got something in reserve should this field begin to concertina, but the likelihood is unlikely. It's only France who may have a chance, 6 seconds behind Germany, but Germany some 15.3 seconds behind race leader Johnny Reid for New Zealand. This is the problem, of course, is getting in behind traffic, and you can lose a couple of seconds very easily. Mexico holding up Johnny Reid.
Yeah, he's
unintentionally
waving.
He's going to get out of the way. He's bound to do so. The race leader coming up behind a slower car. You're allowed a certain number of corners to get to hold a car up, then you've got to get out of the way.
Shaking his fist already is Johnny Reid. He's already had a go, but no way of getting past as yet. He lost over a second to Germany on the last lap, and he does not need
and
to
he's
be held
lose,
up.
He's going to lose maybe. Oh, wheel off the back of Canada. Wheel bounces off the rear of Canada. It bounces into that tire barrier, prevents going into the pitch, but the left rear of Canada has come off on the pitch straight. Sean McIntosh pulls the car up safely against the barrier to the right on the main pitch straight. That left rear wheel suddenly detached there. You can see the nut, the wheel have gone, and Sean McIntosh rolls the car down to the pit lane exit to get that car removed to safety.
New Zealand lost 2 seconds on that last lap, getting stuck behind Mexico. So this race still on, you know, 13 seconds the lead.
Germany now new fastest lap, 1:21.753, and a stunning time.
Canada, though, rolling it into the pit lane exit, all over for Sean McIntosh. He starred at various times in that race, but he also had rather a few amazing incidents.
Well, the wheel, you can suddenly see what happened. The wheel, it just did not detach. The wheel hit the tyre barrier, tyre bales, then it bounces diagonally across the track, and fortunately it hits the tyre bales to protect the area around protection of the entry into the pit lane.
So a scary moment there for Sean McIntosh, losing the left rear wheel.
But we've got 13.4 seconds.
Well, I've just heard Great Britain's had a spin.
Was that flirting with tyres? Was that flirting with the grass? We've seen Robbie Kerr flirt all the race with the grass particularly coming into turn three. That's in turn four, all over for Robbie Kerr, driven a blinding race. We don't know why. Hopefully get a replay and understand what had happened to Robbie Kerr.
The two good friends have ended their races on the same lap. Sean McIntosh and Robbie Kerr out.
And I just wonder, was that maybe also the consequence? Safety car on standby, because Robbie Kerr's car is right in the middle of safety car is going to be deployed. This is going to change this race forever, because we'll now see a safety car on track. It means that New Zealand's advantage of 13.4 seconds has evaporated, all due to Robbie Kerr going track in turns three and four. Well, who's going to say thanks to Robbie after this race?
So the gap that New Zealand had of 13 seconds will be negated.
He's too quick. He's been flirting all afternoon. He almost got it back, but the old pendulum effect. That's a familiar scenario. Well, and he had it. He just stalled it. He pulled the gear to get going again, first gear. He's going to try and get a bump start, and he's decided he's going to drive the car back, but it's outside assistance. So look at all the corner workers. I don't even think half of them aren't even corner workers. They're all running onto the racetrack to try and push Robbie Kerr's car to get it started.
Safety car on track. Meanwhile, well, we've got a slight pause in this frantic action. Let's hear from Sean McIntosh in the pits.
Sean, are you okay?
Yeah, fine. The wheel just fell off the back of the car, so I don't really know what it was, but that was just too bad. It was a bit of an eventful race with all the weather.
I think you're the first person I've seen spinning in a pit lane as well. That was quite scary too. You nearly hit me.
Yeah, I just hit the puddle. I think I just had a bit too much throttle on and just went sideways. So, I mean, feel bad for the guys for a couple of my mistakes, but at the end of the day, we can't do much about this.
How difficult are conditions?
I mean, when we went out in the, with the slicks, it was really slippy for a while, but our car was working well with the wets, and then it was starting to come on there again at the end.
Sean, thanks very much.
Thank you.
So, Sean McIntosh, he's okay, despite the wheel removing company with the car. He drove very well in the midsection. He set some of the quickest laps of the race, but it wasn't to be a result in the end of the day.
No, I think he had a deer in the headlights moment as he came onto those pits when the rear wheel detached. And, of course, it's always a scary moment. There it is again. The wheel just suddenly flies out to the left of the car. And, again, absolutely little that Sean, in fact, he did very well to keep the car pointing in the right direction. Three wheels on my wagon and all that. But it's that wayward tire bouncing from left to right. Fortunately, came to rest safely in that tire bale just there.
Now, where is New Zealand? Why isn't New Zealand behind? Because he's picked up second place, man. Is that why? Just waiting to see them across the line. Yeah, he's waving them through.
Yes, waving them well spotted, because that was Germany leading the head, the chain of cars. There is New Zealand. New Zealand way, way around the racetrack. He's halfway around the racetrack, of course. He hasn't yet. Well, he's come on, virtually a lap ahead of these cars. So the safety car is going to have to let everybody go through and to pick up Jonny Reid. So it's going to take the best part of at least two more laps to get this whole situation under control before this race can be released. There's eight laps to go, but only 6 minutes remaining. We could see this race being a dash for the cash with about 4 minutes or less to go.
Yeah, that's right. It's going to be a real sprint to the flag. That's no doubt about that. Let's hear now from Great Britain's engineer, James Robinson.
James, he had some dramas on the grid and then Robbie's out. He told you what happened?
He actually told us what happened. He was riding with no power boosts at all, so he drove fantastically, and he had a misfire for the whole race, so he drove a fantastic race to that point.
Watching on the monitors, you can see he was getting sideways, getting on the white line. I suppose it looked like he was pushing to the point where that could easily have happened.
It could have done, or he may have been caught out with some of this misfire, so we'll have to wait and see. The data's gone down as well, so we can't see from the data, but drove fantastically to that point. Good calls and good strategy. He was going well.
Thanks a lot, James.
Thank you.
So you can hear the disappointment in James Robinson's voice, but that's the way it's gone, and impressive to hear he was running that quickly with a misfire.
Yes, yeah, so we never could hear the misfire from where we were, but of course with 21 cars in a racetrack, it would have to be pretty bad for us to pick it up. But the fact was Robbie Kerr did drive an outstanding race, showed tremendous amount of courage throughout the race, both on wet weather tyres and then on slicks. But he was flirting a lot of this race, particularly here into turn one with the white line and the grass, also on the exit of turn one and then down into turn three. And it was ultimately in between turns three and turns four that did for him. He almost kept it all together. It was when he was shifting to get that first gear to do a donut to get the car pointing in the right direction. He actually stalled it. So, I mean, a great effort from Robbie Kerr, Team GBR, and praise from engineer James Robinson down in the pit wall of the team.
So the leader is now behind the safety car and everybody else is trying to catch up, and they are doing so. They just went all past us, and of course the next to catch them will be Team Germany's Nico Hülkenberg. So they're going quite quickly at the moment as they try and catch up to the race leader. And everybody will they'll have to wait until they're all in formation before they even think about getting the race underway again. Just 6 minutes to go in this race, so it really will be maybe just one or two laps under green.
Well, here we see Nico Hülkenberg, and he's got a gap from where he is up to New Zealand, but there's no one in sight on that last straight up to turn 10. There is the safety car. There is Johnny Reid for Team New Zealand. But we have to wait for the rest of the field to catch up, and then they have to see the safety car complete that lap.
Let's now hear from David Sears in pit lane.
David, we've just seen Johnny go past in the safety car.
Sorry.
At last, Germany seems to have caught up Johnny. He was tootling around behind the safety car himself for a while. What's the situation?
Well, obviously, Germany, when it pitted for slicks, had a bit of a slow pit stop. Lost 10 or 12 seconds.
As you can see, sorry to interrupt David there, but we've got a spinner, and it's USA.
And USA were in the top six, but now, and he stalled the engine as well. I suspect he has done, because he's not in a position where he couldn't do a donut. So Team USA, and again, we've seen this happen before in that chain of cars. Under a safety car, a car is spun, and that's up at the exit of turn 10 into turn 11. He will need to have that car push started. Can he bump start it? Now, whether that will be considered outside assistance or not will be a matter for the stewards of the meeting to determine. But certainly that car
He's got it running.
But, of course, all the good work that has been done by Phil Giebler and gone on, they're only second-guessing as much as we are, particularly Bennett, will be disappointed, and that's an understatement.
Now, the lights are out, John. We're going to get the race restarted. But when they come back around, there's only going to be about 2.5 minutes, maybe.
They'll certainly get in two full laps. But now there will be one flying lap, and then they get one more lap. So two laps, I'd anticipate, and it'll be the third lap that they'll be flagged off.
It really is going to be the dash for the cash here. $300,000 at stake, remember, for winning the feature race. $200,000 for finishing in second. So it's all about $100,000 between New Zealand and Germany.
Yes, it is. There's two cars between France and these leading two cars. So watch Johnny Reid gets on the power as he comes out of turn 11. The charge down into turn one, defending immediately, not giving the young German any opportunity to sneak down the inside.
The race restarts with just 3.5 minutes to go. Can New Zealand hold on to take their second win of the day, or is Germany going to come back at them? France is actually third and getting past Pakistan.
Pakistan has spun in turn one. Well, I hope that it wouldn't happen, but Noor Ali, now don't let reverse the car back onto the racetrack. Noor Ali, will this be another yellow flag? Will this race end under a yellow flag? Depends how quickly the corner workers can get Pakistan's car pulled to safety.
New Zealand away well, Germany in second place. The yellow car of Australia not playing a part in the top three. He was in the queue, but he's well down the order. He's actually running in 11th position. New Zealand's Johnny Reid really on it on this lap.
And the problem is that in turn one there is a standing yellow flag, so that reduces the opportunity for Nico Hülkenberg to make an attack.
Oh, contact!
Well, I don't know what was going on there with the Swiss. Is that the Swiss car? And Brazil, it just appeared that Brazil was totally unaware that Switzerland was there. And, I mean, Toko Rosch has had a race which has been scrappy at best.
Germany's opportunities are running dry here. New Zealand's Johnny Reid has made a brilliant restart. Can he hold on in front? They won't get the checkered flag this time around. They'll get one more lap, then the checkered flag.
Yeah, indeed. And, of course, no overtaking unless that yellow flag has been withdrawn. It's a green wave flag coming down the pit straight. So can Nico Hülkenberg get in position? No, he can't. Both are using power boost to get maximum horsepower down this straight.
In fact, they'll get two laps, won't they? They'll get this one and one more.
Indeed, I thought three racing laps would be what we would get.
So through that first turn where the yellows were, but very quick through there is New Zealand, and he's opened up the advantage.
Now watch, Tuukka Rosch, totally unaware of what was going on, just drove straight into the side of the Swiss car, and, I think I've said enough about that one.
So Switzerland cut across the gravel. They're running in ninth place at the moment.
Out of turn four, can both gain any advantage over the other? It's very marginal. It looks to me like New Zealand has got sufficient in hand to keep Germany and Nico Hülkenberg at bay. Here we ride on board with Germany into turn six.
Remember, Germany leading the point still, and with their big rival Great Britain out of this race, Does he take the gamble to try and pass New Zealand? Mind you, New Zealand are going to become a major player in the points battle by taking 10 points here today. 9 points for second place, of course, so Germany will maintain quite an advantage over them, and it's a question of whether he takes the risk. Third place, not that car. That's in 11th, that's Australia. But France is running and looking for another podium. Netherlands fourth and Italy fifth.
So they are going to get one more lap with 50 seconds of this race remaining. So this is the last lap. We're about to go into the battle with Italy and the Netherlands. Contact at the back of the Netherlands from Italy.
This is great stuff between these two race winners this year. Race winner at Zandvoort, the Netherlands, up against Beijing race winner Italy, and they're racing for fourth.
And then racing for first position. New Zealand, fastest lap of the race, another penultimate lap.
Italy going past, but he's on the outside. The Dutch car trying to come back in the mid, he can't. Great move by Enrico Tocicello, using the power boost to it perfection. He's in fourth.
So what's going on with the battle for the lead? Germany and New Zealand. New Zealand leads. It was 0.8 of a second as they came across the start-finish line. I think that Germany have decided they'll take the 9 points for second place, and they'll give honour, a double honour this weekend for Team New Zealand, Johnny Reid, and one might say sweet revenge for what occurred back in Brno.
That's right, Johnny Reid, when it has counted, has been brilliant. He struggled in the early laps, there's no doubt about it. His car wasn't working as well as the German car in the early stages, but it was a complete role reversal after the pit stop. Suddenly, New Zealand was flying, Germany was struggling. Johnny retook the lead. It looks as though he's going to hold on to it unless he makes a slip up on the last lap. He's only got a few corners to go here, and it looks as though New Zealand's going to become only the second nation of this second season to do the double, win the sprint race early in the day and come through to take victory in the feature race as well. But it was not straightforward at all. New Zealand come through to win the feature race in Indonesia. Johnny Reid takes the 10 points maximum. Germany finishes in second place, France in through in third, and it's Italy.
Welcome back to Indonesia. Celebrations at the Central International Circuit for Team New Zealand, and deservedly so, a double win for Johnny Reid today, the second country to do that after Malaysia managed it in Brno. Johnny Reid with that double win, impressive stuff from Team New Zealand, the second country to do that after Malaysia, I was saying, in Brno. So impressive from him this weekend. Nico Hülkenberg of Germany pressing Johnny Reid all the way in second spot. Nicolas Lapierre, maybe he's back to his best, but he's now out of the series, but he managed to go out with a bang in third spot for Team France. Enrico Tocicello in the Italian car in fourth. Jeroen Bleekmolen, impressive from him too, in fifth. Alex Jung in sixth.